we will move on to radiation 2. So, we are going to introduce concept of black body. So, in the black body, what is black body? What is black body? The black body is, what is black body? We have understood that any body which is at a finite temperature is going to emit radiation. Now, the radiation is dependent on various other things, that is material of the body, whether the body is surface, the surface is rough or smooth, because that is going to decide the reflectivity and the absorptivity. And the amount of the radiation emitted by a surface depends on its temperature, material and the roughness of the surface. We will worry about these parameters little later on. But first thing is, what if we have to consider the ideal case. Always I take this example. In the class, in thermodynamic cycles, whenever we are teaching, we always refer back to Carnot cycle. Why Carnot cycle? Because the efficiency of the Carnot cycle is highest. I cannot get anything more than that. That is the ideal situation. Similarly, here I have to define an ideal situation or an ideal body which cannot emit, any other body should not be able to emit more than this, or any other body should not be able to absorb more than this. That is the ideal situation. That is black body. Black body is serving as a standard. Black body serves as a standard against which radiative properties of real surfaces can be compared. Why? Because black body. Now, let us see what is black body, what is so ideal about a black body. Black body absorbs all the incident radiation which falls onto it, regardless of the wavelength, whether it is smaller wavelength or larger wavelength, all the incident radiation is absorbed by black body, nothing reflected. That is the point what we understand from this. And for a prescribed temperature and wavelength, no surface can emit more energy than a black body. So, although the radiation emitted by a black body is a function of wavelength and temperature, it is independent of direction. That is, black body is independent of direction. There is no directional sensitivity. So, black body is a diffuse emitter. Three points. That is, it absorbs all the incident radiation. Second point, it no body can emit more than black body for a particular wavelength and temperature. That is very important. And it is not having any directional preference or dependence. It is directionally independent. Black body is a diffuse emitter. These are the three points which we need to note down for black body. Now, the question is, do we come across any black body in real life? Yes. Yes. What is that? That is, I think, the cavity. Cavity can be, I will cover this and then go back to spectral distribution of Planck's distribution. That is, if I take a large cavity and now let us say there is a small hole here in this cavity. What is happening? Whatever is entering into this, first let us see how will it become a perfect absorber. Whatever is entering into this, whatever radiation is entering into this cavity, what should happen? What should it happen? It has to be absorbed, if it has to be a perfect absorber. That is the first definition of our black body. What will happen? If it comes into the cavity, it undergoes multiple reflections and it gets absorbed completely. So, nothing is lost. So, nothing, so the cavity can be visualized as a perfect black body. Now, how can it become a perfect emitter? Now, whatever is coming out in the same way, the way we argued for absorption, same way whatever is getting multiply reflected can also get reflected and get out through this hole. So, that is why it is called as a perfect, I mean it can act as a perfect emitter. That is, I will rephrase this, radiation coming in through the opening area undergoes multiple reflection and thus it has several chances to get absorbed by the interior surfaces of the cavity before any part of it can possibly escape. If the surface of the cavity is isothermal, the radiation emitted by the interior surfaces streams through opening undergoing multiple reflections. That is why it is diffuse in nature, number one, and it is a perfect emitter, number two. It has no preference in direction. That is why cavity acts as a perfect absorber or emitter. And I also take this example always. If I have to calibrate heat flux sensors, radiative heat flux sensors, what do? We create a cavity, we create a cavity, and that is a thin metal foil. I try to keep it spherical, and apply and try to maintain that at constant temperature and put my heat flux sensor somewhere here. This is my sensor. So, whatever this sensor is seeing is essentially because of radiation. Of course, this chamber is now evacuated. Why do I say evacuated? Because I need to exclude natural convection. If there is no medium inside, there is no natural convection, then this cavity can be considered as a perfect black body, against which, why I say perfect black body? Because I can get whatever voltage into current upon the surface area I have, this is my net heat flux which is falling onto my body. So, that is how I can calibrate my heat flux sensor against this black body, So, that is one of the examples wherein which cavity can be used for calibrating heat flux sensors, and cavity can be used as a perfect black body. Okay. So, with this we will move on and try to understand what is called as Stefan Boltzmann law. So, what does Stefan Boltzmann law say? That Stefan Boltzmann law says that radiation emitted by a black body per unit time per unit surface area is that is given by sigma t to the power of 4, that is E b equal to sigma t to the power of 4. What is sigma? Sigma is 5.67 into 10 to the power of minus 8, what is the unit? Watts per meter square Kelvin to the power of 4, watts per meter square Kelvin to the power of 4. So, little later we will understand how did we come across this 5.67. For now, we can just take it as a relation which was given by Stefan Boltzmann. Okay. Actually, this was first found empirically, that is through experiments, that was found by Stefan, and Boltzmann found out this through theory that indeed the sigma is 5.67 into 10 to the power of minus 8. So, it came through experiments first, and it was explained through Boltzmann statistics through later on by Boltzmann himself, and Boltzmann happens to be student of Stefan, and Stefan is his teacher. So, I just want to stop here for a minute and tell who is Stefan and who is Boltzmann. Stefan is an Austrian physicist, and of course, Boltzmann is also an Austrian physicist, and Boltzmann worked with Stefan. Stefan took all the sun's data, whatever was available at that time, and did the simple curve fitting and got that E b equal to sigma t to the power of 4. But why others could not do this? No, they could not do this. Why? Because in all the experimental data, there was conduction losses which was involved. He was the first person to measure the thermal conductivity closest to what we have, thermal conductivity of air closest to what we have today, that is k equal to 0.02635. He got 0.025. Because he could measure the thermal conductivity of air, he could rule out the conduction losses which were there in the experimental measurements. He removed those conduction losses, convection losses, and got the radiation alone, and did the curve fitting, and he could get that sigma as close to, not exactly 5.65, little lower than 5.67, and Boltzmann derived this as 5.67, and Boltzmann was the student of Stefan. Okay. So, through statistical mechanics or Boltzmann statistics, he could arrive with this to this number sigma of 5.67 into 10 to the power of minus 8. Okay. So, with this we will move on. What is the distinction between idealized black body and an ordinary black body? So, point here is, in this transparency I will not read this, the point here is all black bodies, that is black painted bodies, need not be black, and all white surfaces visible through visible eye, whatever white surfaces are visible, whatever white surfaces we see or perceive through eye, are not, we cannot consider them as non black bodies. No, snow is a perfect black body. Snow's emissivity is 1, that is it can act as a perfect emitter. So, it cannot be thought of as non black body. So, whatever we see, the color of the surface does not mean anything about idealized black body, or all black bodies need not be ideal black body. That is the point what I want to tell through this transparency. Okay. and we have seen this perfect cavity. Now, what is spectral distribution? Here we need to go little slow. I want to write this relation, that is, I want all of you to write along with me. So, I lambda comma b, that is I lambda comma b equal to I lambda comma b equal to 2 h c naught square upon lambda to the power of 5, lambda to the power of 5 upon lambda to the power of 5, lambda to the power of 5 exponential of h c naught by lambda k t minus 1. Okay? This was given by Planck, Planck's distribution, that is why it is called as Planck's distribution. What is h? This is universal Planck's constant. I have presented this in the morning, 6.6256 into 10 to the power of minus 34 joule second, and k is not thermal conductivity, 1.3805 into 10 to the power of minus 23 joule per Kelvin. This is universal Boltzmann constant. C naught is velocity of electromagnetic wave in perfect vacuum, that is 2.998 into 10 to the power of 8 meters per second. T is in absolute temperature. In radiation, one important thing we need to remember is that temperature is always in Kelvin. Temperature is always in Kelvin. If we take degree Celsius, we are gone. So, we are going to go way off from our actual result. So, with these constants, what is that we see from this? Intensity of radiation coming out from a black body is a function of only wavelength and temperature. The function is looking something like this, and of course, wavelength is sitting here also. It is a nonlinear function. Now, this was given by Planck. Now, what do we do with this? Let us plot this. So, who is Planck? Of course, in radiation, there are Nobel prizes. Okay? Everyone has got a Nobel prize. Planck has also got Nobel prize for giving the Planck's distribution. So, anyway, I will not spend too much of time because of paucity of time. But I usually give lot of time for historical perspective in the class, but I would request you also to give lot of historical perspective, because the students understand only when we give the historical perspective. So, he got Nobel Prize in 1918 for this Planck's distribution. Now, what did he do? What did Boltzmann do? So, E lambda comma B lambda comma T equal to pi I lambda comma B lambda comma T. What does this lambda comma B represent? Lambda means that intensity is a function of wavelength, and what are whose we are talking about? We are talking about black bodies, and it is a function of wavelength and temperature. That is given by just now whatever I had written, that is h c naught squared upon lambda, 2 h c naught squared upon lambda to the power of 5 exponential of blah blah blah. But where did this pi come from? Pi I lambda comma b. We said that black body is a diffuse emitter. So, emissive power, in the morning Professor Arun has derived it for us, E equal to pi I if it is a diffuse emitter. So, black body is a diffuse emitter. So, I can take emissive power equal to pi I lambda comma b, and that pi is sitting here. So, 2 h c naught squared, I am calling that as c 1, and h c naught by k, I am calling it as c 2, so that it looks little easily, it looks amenable little bit. So, c 1 upon lambda to the power of 5 exponential of c 2 upon lambda t minus 1. So, that means what? All these constants I know, that is c 1 and c 2 I know, and they are represented here. All that I get is emissive power is a function of wavelength and temperature. Now, let us plot this as a function of wavelength and temperature, that is Planck's distribution. So, what is this y axis? The y axis is emissive power, that is watts per meter, spectral emissive power, sorry, it is spectral emissive power, E lambda comma b, that is watts per meter squared micrometer, and x axis is wavelength, you see, and I am plotting it for different temperatures. I said that emissive power is a function of both wavelength and temperature. So, for different temperatures. If we see any temperature, one of the things which we see here, at any given wavelength, emissive power is increasing with the increase of temperature number 1, and for a given temperature, emissive power increases initially, there is a maxima, and subsequently it decreases. All these maxima, if I connect them, then that is a linear line, then if I curve fit that, I get lambda t, that is lambda maximum, that is the wavelength at which it is maximum, lambda maximum into t is a constant, that is what is called as Wien's displacement law. Lambda maximum t equal to 2897.8 micrometer Kelvin. Now, here I want to stop and answer you a question, perhaps you have this question. Here, when we said in electromagnetic spectrum, we said that only infrared waves and visible light and a little bit of ultraviolet, right? Ultraviolet light is responsible for thermal energy. That's what we said. Students usually ask the question, why only this? Why not X-rays? No. You see here, they cannot, other than these waves, they don't carry any thermal energy. There is no emissive power contribution. After this wavelength, what is the emissive power? Zero. After this wavelength, what is the emissive power? Zero. That is the reason. Okay. So, here we have been told to just do some, upload a different file and get back to this file, and what I am doing is I am opening radiation 1. It is for good, it is for good. In radiation 1, I want you to show the spectrum. That is, you see in the spectrum, what did we say? The thermal radiation, blessing in disguise, what you said is right. I was lazy to go come here actually. So, thermal radiation is contributed by ultraviolet, infrared. So, this only, why these two are contributing for thermal radiation, I said I will come back to this question later on. This can be answered through Planck's distribution. In Planck's distribution, only within a particular wavelength, you see, that is for all wavelengths lower than around 0.008. Yeah. 0.08 and maybe above 1000 micrometer, the contributions for thermal radiations is negligibly small. That is why we don't say that. That's why we say that only these waves contribute for thermal radiation. This can be explained only through Planck's distribution. Otherwise, it's quite difficult to explain why only these waves are contributing for thermal radiation. No matter whatever is the temperature, you take an X-ray, there is no contribution for thermal energy. That's the point you can understand from this Planck's distribution. With these insights, let's move on to. Of course, again, Wien also has got Nobel Prize. So, so many Nobel Prizes in radiation. Okay, he has also got Nobel Prize in 1911. Actually, Wien's displacement law was found before the Planck's distribution. So, always student asks why Wien has got, although it is a very trivial thing compared to Planck's, but he had done that first compared to Planck's distribution. That's why Wien has got Nobel Prize. Okay, now if we take this Planck's distribution and integrate this. If you are lost, what did we do? This is what the emissive power we got by putting the intensity of radiation through Planck's distribution. If I integrate this for all wavelengths, what wavelengths? The wavelengths which are contributing for the thermal radiation. Let me go there and get that wavelength, because I am not able to remember that wavelength, but I just want to go and do that. Otherwise, I will be just hand waving that. That is 0.3 micrometer to 3 micrometer. That is from 0.3 micrometer to 3 micrometer. That is, if I have to be very clear, up to 10 to the power of minus 5 micrometers to, oh, there is a problem in this transparency. Okay. So, everywhere it is 10 to the power of minus 5. So, it is between 0.3 to not 3, 15 micrometers. It is 0.3 to, I think I can answer this, the previous transparency. Yeah, that is right. So, that is from 0.3 micrometer to around 10 to the power of minus 8 micrometer is the wavelength range in which thermal radiation contribution is there. Okay? So, with this, we will come back to radiation 2. Now, what do I do is, I will take the spectral distribution and integrate over complete wavelength. If I integrate that, I am going to get sigma t to the power of 4. That is what I am going to get. I think that you can give as an exercise for the students. We have not put that. You can give that as an integration can be given as exercise. That is, you take, although it is 0 to infinity, what my point is, it is not 0 to infinity. Even if you take 0 to infinity, you will be getting automatically, but it is between only that thermal radiation range band, that is 0.3 to 10 to the power of minus 8 micrometers. So, now if you get that, 10 to the power of minus 8 meters, not micrometers. So, if you integrate that, you are going to get E b equal to sigma t to the power of 4, that is I b equal to E b by pi. This is what we use as Stefan Boltzmann. Now, you see why two names are there. Stefan found it experimentally, Boltzmann did this integration and he could find that this is indeed sigma equal to 5.67 into 10 to the power of minus 8. So, this is how we can, I think this is the equation which is used all over the radiation. Okay. So, with this, so Professor Arun wants to add some point here.
See, this area E b lambda, when you integrate with respect to lambda, what do you get? You get E b. So, this area under the curve, under each of these curve, represents the emissive power of the black body at that temperature. So, higher the temperature, greater is the emissive power, and that is logical, right? A body, a black body or any body, black emissive power of black body is easy to understand. 500 degree Kelvin, it has a certain amount of emission. 1000 Kelvin, it has a greater emission. And it is obvious from this diagram, because at 1000 Kelvin, it encompasses a larger spectrum of wavelengths associated. Okay.
Okay. So, what I would request all the participants is that we will be visiting several centers to the extent possible, but limit your questions only to the radiation. We are not going to take any questions on convection. If you have, we will take the questions on convection during tutorial session. Please restrict your questions on radiation. Number one, because Professor Arun is not going to be there in the afternoon. Number two, because subsequently, if your questions are clear, you will be able to understand all whatever we are going to teach radiation downstream. You will be able to understand very easily if you have understood the definitions. So, over to participants for questions.
Sir, the assumption of diffuse surfaces, when is it applicable, sir, or when does it fail? To what kind of surfaces will the diffuse assumption fail?
Okay. So, the question is, when does a surface is diffuse or when does a surface is not diffuse? That is the question. So, that surface which is a black body is a diffuse surface. All surfaces which are closer to black body are diffuse surfaces. See, in the definition of the black body itself, we said three conditions. One is perfect emitter, perfect absorber and diffuse. When will it be diffuse? I will tell you in a very, in a very layman terms. If you take, how do you make a black surface in your lab? Let me ask that question. You take a plate and typically you make a surface black by putting lamp black. That is, by taking a candle and putting the plate below the candle, so that all the soot gets deposited on my plate. Okay. So, now after depositing, if you just see the surface, it looks diffuse. Okay. I should not be using the word diffuse. It looks very, not shining. It is not shining. It is not at all shining. It looks, it is dull. Why? That dullness gives it diffuseness. That is, it is not having any preference. If it is shining, then it is not diffuse. So, to answer your question, all shining surfaces are not diffuse surfaces. Mostly dull surfaces are diffuse surfaces, as long as you paint them with black paint. And there are certain black paints. For example, there is a paint called Pyromark. If you paint any surface with that paint, generally emissivity and absorptivity are equal to closer to 1, not just 1, it is roughly around 0.9495, and even with lamp black you are going to get an emissivity of absorptivity of 0.9596. I am not going to answer you the question emissivity and absorptivity, how do I measure. When I touch upon emissivity and absorptivity, I am going to tell you how do we measure emissivity and absorptivity. I have answered you just when does a surface is a diffuse. Okay.
Sir, is it just a surface property or?
Yeah, Vivek, we will understand this when we get to emissivity and absorptivity. Emissivity is a function of surface, absorptivity is a function of source. We will understand this when we go to emissivity and absorptivity. Yeah.
Hello, sir. I have a question regarding comparison between radiation and conduction. Suppose I am taking two body at a finite temperature difference, so A and B. Now I am taking other losses zero. Now, if I want to thermal equilibrium, in which case, in heat transfer by either conduction or heat transfer by either radiation, I will get the earlier thermal equilibrium condition.
Very difficult question to answer. The question is, if I have two surfaces, and now between the two surfaces, in order to reach thermal equilibrium, whether conduction makes me reach faster or radiation reaches me faster. I cannot answer this in terms of time, but all that I can say is that conduction takes place, conduction is very good in solid and radiation is very good in vacuum. For conduction, I said there is a medium required. If there is no medium, there is no conduction.
It has to be in contact.
One molecule has to get in touch with the other molecule. If there is no molecule itself, then there is no radiation. Is no conduction. So, for radiation, I do not need any molecule, for conduction, I need molecule. So, I cannot compare the way you have asked in terms of time from one surface to another surface, because from one surface to another surface, something has to be filled for the conduction to take place and nothing should be filled for radiation. If it is filled, there is no radiation or minimal radiation between the two surfaces. If there is a medium, then what happens? Radiation gets stunted because the medium which is there starts participating and conduction overtakes. So, that is all I can answer.
Conduction, sir, in a case of conduction, I assume that both the body are in a contact.
That is precisely what we are saying. If both the bodies are in contact, then there is no question of radiation to take place.
Temperature difference is same.
The question is between the two plates, if I have two plates and both are in contact with each other and one plate is higher temperature and the other one is lower temperature, which is the mode of the heat transfer which is taking place? It is conduction.
No. What his question is that if I have two plates at two different temperatures, will bringing them together and keeping them next to each other make them reach thermal equilibrium faster, or will radiative heat transfer give the thermal equilibrium faster? Radiative heat transfer between surfaces depends on several things: geometry, orientation, how far, how close are you from each other. All these things are parameters. So, if I keep them 1 meter apart, it is going to be much slower than if I keep them 1 feet apart. Okay. So, these things are all very variables.
Actually, we will be able to appreciate how much closer or farther resistance. When we get to resistance concept and when we study wave factors. Will you please hold on until then?
Sir, in radiation, we have defined the term radiosity. So, in that radiosity, we have taken the emission radiation, which is emitted plus the reflected rays.
Correct.
So, actually in case of a body, suppose a ray is incident on a body, so it will be, some part of it will be absorbed, some will be reflected and some will be transmitted. So, in case of radiosity, why do we take only the emission and the reflected rays? Why don't we take the transmitted rays, I would say?
Okay. Transmitted has gone away. No, the question asked is, in case of the definition of radiosity, what we are taking is only the emission plus reflection. We are not taking transmission. Why is it so that we don't account transmission into account? Where is the transmission going? The answer is, where is the transmission going? Transmission is going downwards the surface. I am not interested what is going downwards the surface. I am interested what is coming out from the surface. What is coming out from the surface is only emission and reflection, nothing else. So transmission is what goes down, not what is coming out. It is what, it is just going inside.
What is transmitted, passing through.
It is passing through the plate. I am not interested in that. What is getting out of the plate again back is what is I am interested.
Because I am interested in heat transfer between that surface and another surface, hopefully.
Yes.
So that
yes.
surface is giving out energy and also reflecting something.
Correct.
So this part is what is interacting with the other surface.
Yeah, that is what we need to account for. In fact, this radiosity is going to be the major potential when we study the furnace problems or the enclosure problems. We are just going to keep the radiosities into account. Those are the potentials for us in radiation, like temperature was the potential. Okay, any other questions quickly?
Sir, excuse me. How the radiation energy emitted by a surface is changing with respect to dry and moist surface? Is it plays any role for a dry and moist surfaces? How the energy emitted will be?
Okay, the question, the question asked is, if I have a surface, dry surface, and another surface which is moist surface, how do these two surfaces, radiation intensity from these surfaces going to get affected? Does it get affected at all or not? It is little premature, but still I will go ahead and answer your question. The emissivity of the moisture is usually closer to 1. That is, emissivity of water is 1. In fact, if you take the emissivity of the human body, emissivity of the human body is 1. Why? Because we are all made up of water. So, moisture, the plate which is having moisture on it will have higher emissivity compared to that of the emissivity of the dry plate. That is all the answer for your question.
Hello sir, good afternoon sir. When we have derived the expression for differential solid angle in the morning, we have taken that area in the hemisphere and drawn the right angle triangle. Whether it is approximation or is it exact right angle, one figure we have drawn on the whiteboard, sir.
Correct.
So, the angle subtended at point A, whether it is an exact right angle or it is approximation, because that area can be anywhere in the hemisphere, sir. Over.
This figure. Here, the question is actually the triangle, this is perpendicular sign is missing here. Let me put the pointer. The perpendicular sign is missing here. That is not an approximation. It is indeed right angle triangle. That is not an approximation. The question asked is this triangle which we have taken, it is a right angle triangle which is taken, is it an approximation? It is not an approximation. It is indeed a right angle triangle.
I think your question is, because we have drawn it on the surface, you are asking what if the point is on the inside, maybe if that is the doubt, then we don't consider this outside hemisphere, we will consider a hemisphere on which this point lies. So still always that will be a right angle. Okay, so it will be a smaller hemisphere if you are inside. Okay, if you think of the fruit, if you are inside the fruit, you will consider a smaller sphere. That's all it is. So the angle is always right angle.
The question is, refrigerator, backside of the refrigerator is always painted black, and the condenser and compressor is always painted black, and the air conditioning is not having the same criteria. So is it something related to radiation, or it is just the normal convention what we are following?
Professor, but the question asked is for the refrigerator backside is painted black, and for evaporators and condensers in air conditioning, it is not done so. This is an application oriented question. I have no answer. Please put up this in the Moodle. We will think and get back. I want a question pertaining to basics which are taught since morning.
Semblance of black body with that of the cavity, we considered it as an isolated cavity. What is so specific about isothermal cavity? What is so specific about isothermal?
Question is. Correct. The question is, if I take a cavity, the cavity for defining a black body, I took isothermal. That is a very good question. Isothermal body. Why do we take it as an isothermal body? Let us say, the radiation, we said that it is a function of temperature. Now, if I take a cavity, and in the cavity, half of the cavity is half one temperature, another cavity is another temperature, let us say 1000 and 300, then there is radiation between one wall to the half of the cavity to the other cavity. No, it is not so. We have to take complete cavity as one temperature, so that the emission and absorption is same. Otherwise, I have involved one more parameter, that is the temperature. I do not want to take the temperature as a parameter when I am taking the black body. That is the reason.
Another thing is, if different parts of the cavity have different temperature, interaction will bring them to a thermal equilibrium eventually, right?
Yes.
So, it will come and settle down at 750 degree Kelvin or whatever. But it will have to come and settle to a unique temperature isothermally completely. Then only this thing will be valid. Otherwise, it is no longer correct.
One last question for this session.
Question is regarding, yeah sir, basic question. As you told us while answering one of the question, that air is a medium is not participating in the radiation effect. As I know that polar gases like CO2 and NO2 is taking part in the radiation effect. As the air contains such in polar gases, why miss air is not a participating, is not called participating?
Okay, I think the question asked is, the air is combination of carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, oxygen, nitrogen and all, etc. But why is it that air is not participating? You see, usually the inert gases, the air is combined, is a combination of nitrogen, oxygen and then carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide. Carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide are participating, but oxygen and nitrogen are thoroughly non-participating. So, that is the reason why we can consider that as air as a non-participating medium. Yeah, major portion, that is almost 90% of the air is consisting of nitrogen and oxygen. Left out is only carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide, the extraneous gases.
While quoting that examination, as you told that air will get heated up certain temperature.
That is because of carbon. Air is getting heated up because air is having slight amount of carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide, because of which it is getting heated up. That's all. Otherwise, because of oxygen and nitrogen, it is not going to get heated. So, for all practical purposes, we can take that air is a non-participating medium. That's what we do while designing furnaces, for that matter.
That is non-participating, but it's taking participation in the okay.
Very minimally. Okay, I think we will all break for lunch and come back.